تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد, we are still with the book of رياض الصالحين by الإمام النووي رحمه الله, and we are with the section of اليقين والتوكل على الله. يقين is conviction that Allah is the one, that Allah is the Lord, that Allah is the cherisher, the sustainer, the provider, the one worthy of worship. يقين that everything happens, it doesn't happen except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah عز وجل, Allah سبحانه وتعالى is the one who decides everything with his حكمة سبحانه وتعالى. And the tawakkul is depending on Allah. And we talked yesterday, I mean last week, about the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, all the nations were exhibited in front of me, عُرِضَتْ عَلَيَّ الْأُمَمُ. So I saw prophets that they come with people, 9 to 10 people, I mean, 3 to 10 people. Some prophet comes with one man, two men, just followed him after the long message delivery. And some prophets, they don't have anybody even. Anyone. A prophet comes in front of Allah Azza wa Jalla, said, Ya Allah, ballaght. I did my job, but nobody responded. And that tells us what? That you do what you're supposed to do. Result is from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Find the masjid, mashallah, full like this. And then Ramadan, after Ramadan, it's not full. Some masjid doesn't have anybody. Some masjid, people come pray and leave. There's nobody. So this is from Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah. He died before he's even 40 years old. And he did the 40 hadith. Any Muslim, 40 hadith. Doesn't matter what madhab, what maslak, what this, what you say, la ilaha illallah, Imam al-Nawawi at your home. Ikhlas from Allah Azza wa Jal. Maybe he was not as famous when he was alive as he is right now. Right? So you do what you're supposed to do and leave it for Allah Azza wa Jal. When Yawm al-Qiyamah comes, believe me, you don't worry about how many people were following you. You are not a prophet, right? You only worry about that you did the right thing. What if someone have millions and millions of people following them, but they have the riyah in their heart, they have the show off in their heart, they were doing it for the people, it becomes worse. Then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I found a big, huge ummah coming. I thought they are mine, but I was told they are the followers of who? Musa alayhi salam. And then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw a bigger crowd. And they told him, this is your ummah. 70,000 of them will enter Jannah without azab or hisab. Without they being punished. Because someone of our ummah will be punished first. And then they will go to Jannah after. May Allah save us from that. Say ameen. You don't want that. Because this is a, some idea, believe it or not, among the young, among the youth sometimes. Said, oh, well, I'm going to hit Jannah at the end. Oh, good, cool, man. You know, let me do whatever I want, and then, you know, I hit Jannah at the end. Because the measurement here is dunya. Measurement is dunya. I suffer a little bit. It is like the, what they call it, the, no, those competitions. Mud, what's called it? Mud what? Huh? No. This competitions that they go and they struggle and ninja or whatever it's called, like, you know, Iron Man, this kind of thing, right? So I suffer a little bit, but then I take the trophy at the end. This is the kind of thinking. There are some competitions that they run and swim and bike and, you know, go in the mud and climb things and all of this kind of thing. You're tough, you know. Like I go and get punished and get dirty and all of this, but then at the end what? I enjoy, right? So this is the thing, the thinking or the measurement for, you know what, let me enjoy in the dunya, I go to Jahannam a few days and they get to Jannah at the end. That was Ahlul Kitab before. وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً. Only few days and then we enter Jannah. But few days, إِنَّ يَوْمًا عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ كَأَلْفِ سَنَةٍ مِمَّا تَعُدُّونَ. يعني one day with Allah is 1,000 years of yours. So when you say you enter Jahannam, maybe 1,000 days, كده يعني. Or 1 year in Jahannam. Can you take 1 second in Jahannam? الرسول صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said that the person will be brought أهل جهنم يعني من الله عز وجل save us يوم القيامة from the people of جهنم and he will be dipped in it for one second and then taken away. يعني the angels will take that person, just put in جهنم one second and get out. Just one second like this. يغمس في جهنم بس غمسة يعني you know like you bring the bread and you put like in the you know the chicken you know, what they call it, kurma or something like salam and eat. Oh that's how it is. And then bring out fast. Then Allah will ask him, هَلْ رَأَيْتَ نَعِيمًا قَطْ. You lived in the dunya. That person, Rasulullah said, was the most luxurious person in the dunya. But he's destined to hellfire, وَالْعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. And this would be done to him or to her. And then will say, have you seen any luxury? He said, وَاللَّهِ يَا رَبِّ أَنَا فِي الشَّقَاءِ مُنْذُ خَلَقْتَنِي. يعني, I am miserable since you created me. نعيم what? What نعيم? That one dip make them forget everything. And at the same way, person of أهل الجنة, he would be just shown the smell, Jannah, and then come out. And he said, and he was suffering in this dunya. He said, يا رب أنا في النعيم منذ خلقتني. I'm enjoying since you created me. That tells you بس, the smell of Jahannam and the smell of Jannah will make you forget whatever you had in this dunya. And you still think like, I go to Jahannam كده passing by, you are a passerby, you know. And get, لا, طبعا. So, please, inshallah, this is something that we don't want. ندعو الله أن ندخل الجنة بغير عذاب ولا حساب. We ask Allah عز وجل because الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم told عائشة رضي الله عنها من نوقش الحساب عذب. The one that their accounts will be discussed with them, for sure they will be punished. يعني if Allah discusses the account, the audit يعني with someone and he says, you know, why you did this, why you did this, why you did this, that means they will be punished for sure. But الحساب اليسير of the Muslim, what is حسابا يسيرا for Muslim? The easy account. You know what is the easy account? That Allah will review it with you. And you don't deny it. You did this such and such day, right? Right. You did such and such day, right? Right. As I covered you in the dunya, I forgive you in akhirah. Allah Azza wa Jalla will say. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. That is فسوف يحاسب حسابا يسيرا. That is the meaning. حسابا يسيرا means you agree. Is there anything wrong in here? No, I agree. You forgiven. Don't you want that? That is hisab, right? That's hisab of the Muslim. No, some Muslims will not have even that hisab. That's what Rasulullah is talking about. So first one, they will not have azab. Second one, they will not even have hisab. 70,000. So one Sahabi, Ukash ibn Muhsin, came, Ya Rasulullah, make dua for me that I am among them. He said, you are among them. Then another one else said, no. سبقك بها عكاشة. عكاشة already took that. The ulama had an issue with this one. He said, why second one? It was easy. So some of them said, Rasulullah does not want the door to be opened for someone who does not qualify. Because Rasulullah does not say no to people. Like he likes to say, okay, okay, okay. But then this would be open and there was lots of munafiqeen in Medina. Right? Lots of hypocrites in Medina. And they would wish to make Rasulullah to make the dua for them. If Rasulullah made dua for someone, it's accepted. That's why even the Yahud, people of the book in Medina, they used to tell Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم when they sneeze, they come sneeze in front of him, right? They come and make up a sneeze like this. So he says, يرحمكم الله. They want to rahma, huh? If he says, يرحمكم الله, Allah forgive. Right? So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم used to say, يهديكم الله. May Allah guide you. So they sneeze in front of him. That tells you that if somebody asks Rasulullah for dua and he makes the dua, خلاص, sealed. So that's why Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم did not want to open that door for who does not deserve. That's one answer. The other answer, they said, we don't know the name of that person who asked him. Maybe that person was like that himself. Okay, anyways, the proper way is that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he does not want to open the door, but he answered in a nice way. رد لطيف يعني. يعني sometimes you don't tell people yes, and you don't tell people no, but you tell people nicely. One of my sheikhs, subhanAllah, I learned from him lots of adab, you know that. When you know you become a very lucky student, when you learn from your sheikh, the adab more than the knowledge. Trust me. that when you learn the, you know, beyond the information, information we forget. I give you plenty of information, and my sheikh give me plenty of information. Very hard to retain all of this. It will come over time. You know, it's like a slow release. You know, like, oh yeah, that's what I learned 10 years ago, something like that. But al-adab, you get it right there. How they look, how they talk, how they reply to people. This is the thing actually we need to teach our students. These are the issues. And then when they have those containers and those molds, they can put in it whatever they want. You're with me? So this Sheikh, subhanAllah, people ask fatwa sometimes, question. So he answers. Sometimes he gives short answer, sometimes he gives long answer, sometimes moderate answer, depending on the person. Depending on the person. So if a person is like, knows fiqh and hadith and tafsir and all of that, then the Sheikh goes a little bit deeper. If someone asks for, Sheikh, could I do this or not? No. Yes? Yes. Because such and such. Like, depending on the person. Sometimes you have those smart brothers and sisters, you know, smart. What I mean by smart? Smart, mashallah. But they come and say, but Sheikh such and such said. Right? But I heard another opinion, this and this and this. So the Sheikh used to reply, inshallah, I will go and study it a little bit more. And khalas, the situation is done, right? Then they will come do this again and said, inshallah, I will study it such much more. And does not answer that, more than that. Why? Because now you are not asking for knowledge. Okay? Now you are doing what? You know, shopping, comparing, trying to make the Sheikh change his mind. Or maybe he doesn't know what the other Sheikh said. You see that? Those are the things. So Radd al-Latif, instead of saying, well, I know what you're talking about, and you should have some adab when you are asking me, right? That's one way to offend the person, right? It's his right to say, akhi, learn your adab of asking question and this and that. It's his right to say this, but he doesn't want to hurt the person's feeling. At the same time, he does not want to withdraw completely. So he says, inshallah, I will check that knowledge, I will study more. I did not get it except after 3-4 times. From the Sheikh, seeing, why is he saying, I study? You know it, ya Mawlana. Sheikh, you know it. You know, he looks at you and smile, right? Why you didn't answer him, you know? Give it to him. Give it to him, ya Sheikh. You know, so he learned how to ask next time. But the Sheikh keeps saying it, and the people, subhanAllah, they learn. They do learn. So why I'm telling you this? This is sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When you learn such adab like this, then you apply it in different ways. I hope you get the idea, right? So sometimes you don't want to push the person away, and sometimes you don't want to go with them in what they say, because it's not right. So you can teach them in a different way. Right? So in a different way. But subhanAllah, we need also to stop to get offended. When you are not given what you want, don't get offended. Yani. Think about it. Why this was the case. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did that. Also another ishkal in the hadith. Ishkal, you know what ishkal is? Mushkil, yani there is a problematic issue with it. Ishkal in the hadith, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, those are the ones, لا يسترقون. Yani they are not asking for ruqiyah. Okay? Ulama also differed. Like, what if I have a problem? يعني أنا, I feel lethargic, I feel tired, I feel bad. I went to the doctors and I went to the psychiatrist, and everybody said, you're fine. There is nothing wrong with you. But I'm still feeling the. Then I should go to someone pious, righteous, sheikh, someone who knows ruqya, sheikh, say, Arqini. So what is wrong with that? And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, they don't ask for ruqya. To enter Jannah without hisab or adab, they don't, one of the conditions that they don't ask for ruqya. So what, this is ishkal, right? So the ulama here said that when you ask for that, means your tawakkul on Allah is a little bit less. It takes away from it. But the actual opinion that I lean toward, which is a large number of ulama, they said that they ask before they get the issue. You know, someone does not have a problem, but they just have some doubt. And they didn't go check with the doctors, they did not check with anything, and they said, I want ruqya, so nobody can nobody can evil eye me, or nobody can do sihr to me, or nobody can do that, so please do ruqya for me. Those are the ones that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam talking about. But when a person needs it, there is no problem in asking. You get the point? So those are the ones who are not asking preventive. They are asking for cure, that's all right. Which I lean toward this, you know, there's nothing wrong in asking for the ruqya if you need it. Also, it's a good thing that if you know, if you, any one of us, know someone needs ruqya, ask for them. Okay? So if someone of your family members need, ask for them. So we learn how to ask for each other. Okay? Akhi, you need to go get the ruqya. Sheikh, please give the ruqya to this person. So you save them from asking. Also, the person when to follow carefully, right? So number one, if you don't have it, don't ask for it. That's number one. Number two, learn how to ask for others you think that they need it. All right? Number three, if you see someone and you know how to do ruqya, you should do it. You should offer to give the ruqya. Number four, if all of this is not available, at least try to indirectly show the person that you need ruqya. You know, I have such and such and such and such and I really don't know what to do. Something like that. Right? So indirectly, إِنَّ فِي الْمَعَارِضِ مَنْدُوحَةً عَنِ الْكَذِبِ. يعني just make like some hint, give some hint. So all of this will save you from, you know, debate of the scholars and all of this, and inshallah you become among those who are not asking without need or asking directly. Right? So that's that part, inshallah, رب العالمين. And also Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ. No, kay means the branding with the fire of the vein or the artery that it is hurt. You know, people they used to go to war or something like that and they get hurt. And then there are some of those veins that if they cut, a person dies. So when they didn't have medicine, they didn't have like emergency, they didn't have blood transfusion like we do now. Okay, so at that time, what is the quickest thing that they used to with fire, you know, iron and fire and branded that? Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did himself when he cut one of his artery in Battle of Al-Ahzab. One arrow came, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote him and he did twice. But it busted again and he died as a shaheed, radiyallahu anhu. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the arsh of Allah, the throne of Allah shook upon his death. And when they brought him, Rasulullah said, everybody stand up for your master, you know. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, great Sahabi of Rasulullah, the leader of Al-Aws. So here Rasulullah is the one who did it himself. Does that mean Rasulullah does not enter Jannah without hisab or adab? No, the ones who are asking again for it without any need or anything like that. La yaktawun means the ones who are asking for it. But if it, you are doing it, actually you are muhsin. When you help someone in need with the ruqya or with the kay or with the medicine or something like that, you are the one who is actually doing ihsan to them. But they should not be asking for it without need, as we mentioned. So understand that hadith, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa ala rabbihim yatawakkalun, they depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in everything. Wa man yatawakkal ala Allah fa huwa hasbuhu. Allah suffice for the person who depend on him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah suffice for you, khalas. What you care about, what people say or what people do. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. May Allah make us among them. There is other narration that says with every one of the 70,000, Allah gives shafa'ah to 70,000, inshallah. So each one of those 70,000 will make shafa'ah for 70,000. So may Allah make us among those millions, inshallah, رب العالمين, who enter Jannah بغير حساب ولا عذاب. Hadith الثالث, the third hadith in this section, which is 76, hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas again, رضي الله عنهما. And this is حديث حديث موقوف. موقوف means the صحابي is the one who's saying. He's not saying Rasulullah said, but he is making a statement. And this is very important for you to learn about science of hadith, right? Science of hadith. When we say the word hadith, it does not mean a statement of Rasulullah only. It's a statement of صحابي or even a statement of تابعي. Then there are many, many, many classifications for that statement. Is this the statement of the Sahabi independent? or a statement from the Sahabi that he cannot make on his own. يعني he's talking about things that will happen يوم القيامة or things that happened in the nations before or the things that they have the you know instructions of the deen. He cannot come up with that by himself. So they said له حكم المرفوع. For sure he learned it from رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم because a Sahabi رضي الله عنه ورضوا عنه cannot lie. Yes? So Allah said, I am pleased with this man. Can he lie on Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم? Can he make something up? So يعني in the science of hadith, there are technicalities in there. Is he saying about the nations before? Nations before, okay, did he get it from Rasulullah or did he get it from the book of the people of the book? If he get it from the people of the book, what is the hukm? Does it agree with what we have or does it agree with what we have? You know, there are many, many things. So let's see this hadith, which is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما حديث عبد الله بن عباس. What he says عبد الله بن عباس, he says حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. We know that statement, right? Allah is suffice for us. حسبي, حسبنا, enough for us, suffice. حسبنا الله, يعني Allah is suffice for us. ونعم الوكيل, يعني he is the best وكيل. We make توكل on him, يعني he is the one that I depend. When you make someone وكيل for you, you said you are وكيل, go buy this for me, means they act on your behalf. But when Allah is your wakil, means you surrender everything to him. Everything to him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you know what tawakkul means? Tawakkul means hasbunallah wa ni'ma al-wakil. So what Abdullah ibn Abbas says, that statement. Hasbunallah wa ni'ma al-wakil. Qalaha Ibrahimu alayhi salam. Who said it? Sayyidina Ibrahim, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Hina ulqiya fi an-nar. When he was thrown in the fire, you know the story, yani. After he destroyed their idols, right? And then they come and say, he said, oh, the big one, and they, you know, said, you're mocking us, you know, they gather the wood, they throw him in the fire. When he was thrown in the fire, what did he say? Hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakeel. Abdullah ibn Abbas says, وَقَالَهَا مُحَمَّدٌ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Also, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said it. حِينَ قَالُوا, when people told him, إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. When people told him, people gather for you. After battle of Uhud, when Abu Sufyan, before he became Muslim, Abu Sufyan took the people and they went back to Mecca. They defeated the Muslims. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was injured and all of this. 70 people died, Hamza, all, you know the story, يعني battle of Uhud. So Abu Sufyan went, Rasulullah was injured in Medina, and all of these people, you know, they're really in pain. قرح, من بعد ما أصابهم القرح, you know, قرح والقرح, and that's too much, you know. Sufyan, well, we did not invade Medina, we did not kill Rasulullah Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, we did not capture anyone, we did not do anything. What did we actually achieve, يعني? Normal victory, no, we need to go and finish. So they send someone, said, you know what? This was round one. It doesn't count. We're coming for you. And this time we're coming to finish it. Now, can you imagine someone who was defeated, injured? You know, they are trying to bring themselves back together and heal. And here is the second blow. Actually, second blow will be the one, يعني, right? So, إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ. Oh, they gathered bigger army and they're coming and all of that. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ ونعم الوكيل. Let's go. And they actually went. All of them. طبعاً there are different various narrations about this, but one said that Rasulullah took the Sahaba and he said, only those who were with me in Uhud, not anybody else. يعني those who were injured, those who were suffering, to the point that they used to, some of them used to be carried by someone to sit on their camel or their horse. To that level, right? He said, we will go again and hasbunallahu ونعم الوكيل. He camped for 3 days and they were scared to come. So فانقلبوا بنعمة من الله وفضل لم يمسسهم سوء. So the ni'mah of Allah, the defeat became what? Victory, and they were not touched by any harm. Subhanallah, when they said what? حسبنا الله. That is why the ulama said there are certain du'as in the Quran why we are not paying attention to. This is one of them. Allah Azza wa Jalla says all the dua followed by the letter fa. Followed by the letter what? Fa. Say it. Letter what? when it is followed by letter fa means there was no time between the dua and the response. Means it will happen. وقالوا حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل فانقلبوا بنعمة من الله وفضل. Right? When the person, فانقلبوا means they changed, the situation changed. You know the believer of Al Fir'aun, Fir'aun, when he was doing what he is doing to Musa عليه السلام, one of his family members believed in Musa عليه السلام. سبحان الله. And in Surah Ghafir, Surah Al-Mu'min, after him, يعني it's named after him, Surah Al-Mu'min. What did he say? After they did not listen to what he says. He says, فَسَتَذْكُرُونَ مَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. You remember what I told you and you didn't listen. وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. I give up on you now. But everybody is with Allah عز وجل. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. Allah is watching over. فَوَقَاهُ اللَّهُ. فَوَقَاهُ اللَّهُ. You see the fa? Allah saved him from their makr. So when you have people against you, you said, وَأُفَوُّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. See the dua? Sayyidina Yunus alayhi salam, when he was in the belly of the whale, and he repented to Allah Azza wa Jal. قال, what he says, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. See the fa? فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. And we responded. سيدنا أيوب عليه السلام, ربي إني مسني الضر وأنت أرحم الراحمين فاستجبنا له. You see? So remember this kind of du'as. When you're reading the Quran, that's why I'm telling you read one juz a day. Right? And try to see those things, the du'as. Make it an assignment, subhanAllah. Yes, you can Google whatever. No, but this is the easy route. But try to make an extra effort. I am going to read the Quran and I will pick all the du'as and write it down. Ayah number, this number, that number. And then try to print them and have them. This is the du'as of the Quran. MashaAllah. You read one juz a day and you came up with this. I am going to read the ayat of Al-Jannah. Every time Jannah mentioned, I'm going to do what? You can Google, as I said, but I want you to do it yourself. Enjoy doing this list. Find a topic of your interest. And get it for the young people. I'm going to get all the animals in the Quran. I'm going to get all the plants in the Quran. I'm going to, fine, okay. Just to do something to feel connected. And then you make your own list. Ramadan 1438, 2017. I made that list. Maybe your great grandchildren will see it one day. SubhanAllah, ikhwani, I'm opening doors for you. This is how to depend on Allah Azza wa Jal. This is how to make tawakkul on Allah. So Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, so Abdullah ibn Abbas saying this, two people, two prophets, they said this. In another narration in Sahih al-Bukhari also, he said, كَانَ آخِرُ قَوْلِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. Last thing he said, حِينَ أُلْقِيَ فِي النَّارِ, when he was thrown in the fire, حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. He said it now with the singular form. First one he said حَسْبُنَا, حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. Here he says حَسْبِيَا, me, and حَسْبِيَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. So it gives you the option, especially if as a community we are under something, we should say what? حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. Even if I am myself only saying it, so I say حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ because I'm not the only one who is under this. It's other Muslims as well, so we should say the plural form. If it is something only concerning you say what? But if you said حسبنا, no problem as well. No problem, inshallah, رب العالمين. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are both having the title of Khalilul Rahman or Khalilullah. Khalilullah, Ibrahim alayhi salam. Some people they said Ibrahim Khalilullah, Muhammadun Habibullah, Musa Kalimullah. You hear that, right? But that's not accurate. موسى عليه السلام كليم الله, that's okay. وكلم الله موسى تكليما, that's his title. That's his title, right? والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned that. That's the title of سيدنا موسى عليه السلام. But إبراهيم عليه السلام خليل الله, also consensus. خليل يعني close friend of Allah. But to say رسول الله محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم حبيب الله, you're putting a degree down. Because محبة is lesser than خلة. You know, خلة خليل is higher than حبيب. You know, you can love someone, but they are not that close to you. You have differences with. Still, you love them. But you know, خليل means that's so close to the point that whatever they do, they're okay. Right? You are that close to them means they have a pass. خليل means that close to Allah Azza wa Jal. That's it. You know, we pass that level of only love. Only two have that. Ibrahim alayhi salam and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Khalila Allah. So they are both the khalil of Allah. Al-khalilani huma Ibrahimu wa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is the father and son. Yani. Right? This is the father and the son. يعني ملة أبيكم إبراهيم. In the Quran, he says Ibrahim is your father. Ibrahim is our father. If you're Muslim, Ibrahim is your father. إبراهيم عليه السلام هو أبيكم ملة أبيكم إبراهيم هو سماكم المسلمين. Who called you Muslims? إبراهيم عليه السلام ملة أبيكم إبراهيم. سيدنا إبراهيم, we know the story that they said حرقوه, you know, burn him, حرقوه, and because he invited them to the Islam, to monotheism, but they kept worshipping the idols, and you know the story. And Allah Azza wa Jal make the hellfire, make the fire that he was thrown in, burden, because he said, حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل. حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل. Bukhari mentioned this actually in a section that قول الله عز وجل حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. So he, Imam al-Bukhari mentioned that الذين قال لهم الناس إن الناس قد جمعوا لكم فاخشوهم فقالوا حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل فزادهم إيمانا وقالوا حسبنا الله ونعم. تفسير of that ayah, يعني that hadith is mentioned. So this is a statement for Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he cannot get that knowledge from himself. يعني so this even the statement for Abdullah ibn Abbas, it takes the ruling of the hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. So when he said حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل, سيدنا إبراهيم قلنا يا نار كوني بردا وسلاما. Of course, the dua will be accepted, especially from the Prophet of Allah. Bardan wa salaman, not bardan only. Not bardan only. So cannot be cool only. He will die freezing. But bardan wa salaman, peace. You know, it's bardan wa salaman. And these are the two things, you know, two characteristics that they need each other. And it happens many times in the Quran with food, for example. فكلوه هنيئا مريئا. هنيئا مريئا. You don't want مريئا only, you don't want هنيئا only. You know, هنيئا مريئا, هنيئا مريئا. يعني هنيئا, you enjoy it. مريئا, it goes through peacefully. It does not hurt because you can enjoy the food, mashallah, in your mouth. But you know, when it comes, يعني مشكل. Either it goes so fast, you have a problem, or it goes so slow, you also have a problem. Yes? So this is what happens. Some food will give you, يعني, you know, things will open up, you cannot close it. And sometimes they are so tight that you want it to come out, but it is not. Sometimes the heart burns, sometimes there are issues. يعني, subhanAllah. So this is where the word مريئن comes. مريئن, يعني it goes through the passage until it's out easy. هنيئاً, you enjoy. So you want the food to have those two, هنيئاً and مريئاً. Same thing here for that fire. It needed to be burden because the heat, but not burden, it will keep going burden. وسلاماً, يعني safe as well. So we need always to have a good job with no problems in it. You have children, but they are not an issue. You have a spouse who does not give you hard time. You want to come to the masjid and leave, alhamdulillah, benefiting. You understand? So always don't focus on one aspect and leave the other important aspect. Always ask Allah Azza wa Jal to give you the, you know, the both ways. Yeah, it is dying. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, in this hadith, he said that those who said حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ نِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ, Allah Azza wa Jal save them from all problems. What time is Ishraq? Huh? Now, yeah. So 5 more minutes, inshallah. want to hold you, so we all can pray inshallah that we raka'ah and get the reward inshallah, all of us inshallah. Whoever prays Fajr and sit until the Ishraq, you get the reward of what? Hajj wa Umrah kaman. Why you are miser? Hajj wa Umrah, Hajj wa Umrah, every day Hajj wa Umrah, alhamdulillah. But you still have to go Hajj wa Umrah, right? You just get the reward, you don't get the replacement. There is no replacement here. Even if you stay all your life praying Fajr, you get the reward of Hajj wa Umrah, fine. But you still have to do that. Yeah. Al-Hadith al-Sadis in this section and 79 in this. عن عمر رضي الله عنه سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول and this is by the way the highest level of the hadith and we say سمعت يقول لو أنكم تتوكلون على الله حق توكله لرزقكم كما يرزق الطير تغدو خماصة وتروح بطانا رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن خماص يعني ضامرة البطون من الجوع وترجع بطانة أي ممتلئة البطون. He says, سيدنا عمر said, I heard Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم myself, I heard Rasulullah says, if you really have tawakkul on Allah the way it should be, if you really have the full tawakkul on Allah, He will for sure provide you and give you rizq like He gave to the birds. The birds come out from their nest empty stomach, but they come back to it full. يعني where is the bird that goes hungry comes back hungry has to find something he gives risk سبحانه وتعالى to the birds birds are not worried they have that discussion in the morning you know what I'm going to do today you know how I'm going to pay the bills how I'm going to just go and they know they will come back Allah gives the risk طبعا bird مسخر يعني does not have choices does not have anything مسخر you know they are asked Allah give them this program to do this, that, and that. But we have the understanding. So Sayyidina Umar said, if you reach in tawakkul level, you will get the risk like that. For sure, subhanAllah. But we worry, and we are da'if, right? But Allah Azza wa Jalla, may Allah take that away from us and make us really depend on Allah. Tawakkul haqiqi. يعني you really depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khimas, khimas. The word khimasan, يعني they're hungry, nothing in its stomach. That's why Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فمن اضطر في مخمصة. يعني when a person is so hungry, starving to the point that they will die, and there is only haram food or drink to eat or drink from, they can take غير باغ ولا عاد. And you are not wanting this, and oh, here is my chance now to eat pork and drink wine, you know. That's غير باغٍ. ولا عادٍ, يعني he is not transgressing. Oh, let me have the good meal now. Let me have the full meal. No, just only what is required, and not with the desire, right? So, مخمصة لا خماصاً. يعني you're so hungry to that level. Only you depend on Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this hadith there are a few things. One, that you depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fully. Then you take the means, there's nothing wrong with that. You go to apply for the job, you do your job, you have to watch your health, you have to do right, you have to build the house as your shelter, right? You have to make it comfortable, you have to make sure your gas, the oil levels, the, all of these things has nothing contradicting tawakkul, eh? Contradicting tawakkul. You are doing what Allah wants you to do. Because what are you doing? You're taking the means that Allah created for you. Allah made available for you. Nothing wrong. But your heart there, don't let it go up and down. Don't let it go sideways, I'm sorry. Away from this. If I don't do this, I'm not going to. No, it's Allah Azza wa Jal. First, then these things second. So also we learned that nobody and nothing on this earth except the risk comes from وَمَمِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا Surah Hud, Allah said nothing alive making a move on this earth except risk comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allahu Akbar So anyone who think that if I have more children I will have less risk Or if I do this, I don't do that. If that's actually assuming bad about Allah Azza wa Jal. You are actually as if you are saying that Allah will not help me in this one. Allah will not be able to take care of this one. Yes, we become wise and we organize our life, but don't think that what you do affects what Allah can do. I repeat this again. Don't think whatever you do affects what Allah can do. Is that clear for? Think about what I'm saying here. Don't think what you do will make Allah act in a certain way beyond his ability or less in ability or anything like that. It doesn't work like this. You can do with hikmah according to the pattern of human beings, but it doesn't work. If I do this, then Allah will do that. If I don't do this, then Allah will not do that. Who are you? Who are you to say this? Who are you to say this? Yes, you can do what people taught to do. Yeah, but no. He's not like someone, you know, he's not like your CEO in your company. If I do this, then my CEO will. If I don't do this, then I will not. If I do this, I get a bonus. If I don't do this, my paycheck gets less. That's us مع بعض كده This is us with each other. But with Allah Azza wa Jal, خزائنه واسعة يعني. Allah can tighten it for anybody, for somebody who doing everything right by our measurements. They studied in the best college. They applied for all the jobs. They have what it takes, but there is no job for them. And someone who does not have anything, and he becomes a billionaire. So don't deal with Allah in a way that, okay, if I do this, then I get this. If I have two children, then I am good and I will have the house and the car. If I have seven children, it's not going to happen. So let me tighten it and I don't want to. It doesn't work like that. Believe me, it doesn't work like that. There are many people, Allah gives them the rizq because of more. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نُرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ Don't kill the children because of fear of poverty. We give them and you. So them. The rizq comes with them. Not like that. Okay, so you have to understand that. And Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who gives rizq to everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have to believe in the hikmah of Allah. Look at the birds, you learn lots of things. Look at the animals, you learn lots of things. From the ants, you see perseverance. And you see they go after. You change the direction, they keep going back and back and back. They'll never give up. We learn from that. You see the birds going, subhanAllah, the formations and all that, community. Community. I was driving 2 days ago here in Cyprus with Orloeta, one of the two, coming to the masjid here before Ramadan. And subhanAllah, I see this little duck, wallahi akhwani, duck, and it has three, four, ducklings, chicks. In the middle of the road, the way I saw, I did not see passing but they were in the island, like in the in the middle. And every car, and the duck goes like this and comes back. And all of them, they follow, like it's automatic. It's like they are connected somehow. Moves the head, everybody moves the head. Goes to the left, everybody goes to the left. So all the, and I'm seeing this, two, three cars behind. And the cars go. I stopped, I stopped to give the hazard. And the other guy on the side stopped to give the hazard until they crossed. It was beautiful. It was amazing. But you see how the mother and children. I wish we as humans learn like this. I wish we do learn like this. I wish that I am like this and my children behind me like this, right? And the mother goes like this and the children wish. It's a wish, right? Until they, and you see, if there are hundreds and hundreds, I'm sure many of you saw YouTube with sheep, kharuf yani. There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, and there is one leader. Sah? He goes right, everybody right. Goes left, everybody left. Goes behind, everybody behind. Allahu Akbar. We learn, animals. We learn from them many things, subhanAllah. So may Allah guide us, and may Allah give us this sense of tawakkul on Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Depending on Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, learning how to use the means that He created for us subhanahu wa ta'ala, function as a community for His sake subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah guide us, guide our children, guide our spouses, unite our community. صلى اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين. Anybody, inshallah, have a question or comment?